that I heard Abu Huraira, the companion Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, saying, "These two ears of mine have heard, and these two eyes of mine have seen Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam take the palms of Hassan, his grandson, or Hussein, into his own hands, and he put his little feet on the feet of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, "Climb up." So the boy, he climbed up, meaning his grandson, Al-Hassan or Al-Hussein, he climbed up until his feet were on the chest of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, "Open your mouth." So then he kissed him. And then he said, "Oh Allah, love him, for indeed I love him." So this hadith is collected by Imam al-Bukhari here in this particular work, Al-Adab al-Mufrad. However, the hadith is da'if. The hadith, it is weak. However, the dua that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he mentioned, it is authentically reported in the two sahihs, meaning Bukhari and Muslim. Of course, Imam al-Bukhari has other works. This is just one of his works, his famous work that all of the Muslims are familiar with, Sahih al-Bukhari. In Sahih al-Bukhari, there is another wording of this hadith in a slightly different context. And that hadith states that Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, and likewise Imam Muslim, Imam al-Bukhari, I think it is in the chapter of garments, that, and likewise Imam Muslim in his narration, and this is the wording of Imam al-Bukhari from Abu Huraira, that Abu Huraira said, "Kuntu ma'a Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi suqin min aswaq al-Madina." He said that I was with Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a market from the marketplaces of Medina. So he turned, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned. So he said, and I turned. And then he said, "Where is that child? Where is the child? Where is the child?" And he said it three times sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he said, "Ud'u al-Hasan bin Ali." He said, "Call Hassan, the son of Ali," meaning go and call my grandson. So Al-Hassan bin Ali, he came, and around his neck was a beaded necklace. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stretched out his hands, and Hassan did the same, meaning that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indicated with his hands, and he stretched them out. And Hassan radiallahu anhuma, as a young child, he did the same. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam embraced him, and he said, "Allahumma inni uhibbuhu fa'ahibbahu wa'ahibba man yuhibbuhu." Allahu Akbar. He said, "Oh Allah, I love him, so love him too, and love those who love him." Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, who was the companion watching all of this take place, he said, "Since Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said those words, none has been more dearer to me than Hassan, the son of Ali radiallahu anhuma." In the narration of Imam al-Bukhari, there is another wording from Bukhari and Muslim, from Bara'a radiallahu anhu, who said that I saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam carrying Al-Hassan upon his shoulders, and he was saying, "Allahumma inni uhibbuhu fa'ahibbahu." Oh Allah, indeed I love him, so you love him. This hadith, my brothers and sisters, even though the hadith of Al-Adab al-Mufrad from Amana, from the trust that the people of knowledge they must have, and anyone who's teaching he must have, it is not allowed for him to lie about a hadith of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that whomsoever narrates from me that which I did not say, then let him take his seat in the hellfire. So it is from Amana and from the trust that a person who is disseminating knowledge and teaching the people, that if a hadith is weak, no matter how beautiful it sounds, no matter how much it affects our heart, if it is weak, it cannot be ascribed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the initial hadith of Al-Adab Al-Mufrad, it is weak. But the fact that there are other narrations in a slightly different context, like the narration of Abu Hurairah and the narration of Al-Bara, that both of these narrations are authentic. Slightly different context, one of them mentions that Al-Hasan was upon his shoulders. The other one mentions that they were in the marketplace and the Prophet ﷺ called for his son, where is Hasan? His grandson, where is Hasan? Where is that child? He was looking around, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, such that Abu Hurairah started looking around. He says, where's that boy? Where's that young child? Where is Hasan? Call Hasan bin Ali. And this is another point of benefit for us also, that how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam honored Ali also, radiallahu anhu. He's specifying a particular grandson and honoring his father, Al-Hasan, the son of Ali, radiallahu anhuma. So in these hadith is a proof, first and foremost for us, as far as the context of the hadith is concerned, that we refer to the authentic hadith and they are sufficient for us than to be quoting weak hadith. Because weak hadith you cannot ascribe to the Prophet ﷺ. It cannot be said that the Prophet ﷺ said, and yet the hadith is weak. Because that means he didn't say it. It means that there is a weakness in the chain of narration. And you find many of the Muslims today, that of course the hadith literature runs into tens and thousands. Just the Musnad of Imam Ahmad Ibn Hanbal rahimahullah ta'ala has 40,000 and odd narrations. One book of Imam Ahmad. But not all of the hadith are authentic. He brings the chains of narration, so it is upon the scholars of hadith throughout the age, because he has fulfilled his trust. What was his trust? I am narrating to you a hadith with this chain of narration. It doesn't mean that every single narrator is trustworthy, precise, reliable, that he has, you know, that he has precision in narrating. I'm not saying that. All I'm saying to you is, here's my chain of narration. Imam al-Bukhari did that. Ibn Abi Shaybah did that. Imam Malik did that in his Muwatta. Abu Dawud did that. At-Tirmidhi did that. You know, Ibn Majah did that. All of the scholars were doing that in hadith, except Bukhari and Muslim, because they set themselves a task. Bukhari and Muslim, when they narrated hadith, they had a particular intent in mind, that we will not gather in our works except that which is authentic. So therefore, they raise the bar high. Nothing will come into my work. Imam Bukhari in Sahih al-Jami' of Imam al-Bukhari, he said, nothing will enter into it except that it meets certain conditions. And Imam Muslim followed him in those footsteps. As for many of the other scholars of hadith, that they did not raise the bar that high. What they said was, we're going to narrate the hadith with his chain of narration and we fulfill the amana. It wasn't just Bukhari and Muslim, that Ibn Khuzaymah did the same in his Sahih. He said, I'm only going to collect the hadith which are the most authentic, and he raised the level high, that I'm not going to include except that which is Sahih. That does not mean that every single hadith without fail. Why? Because these are human beings, and human beings fall short. It doesn't mean that every single hadith, that every scholar of hadith, whether it be Bukhari, whether it be Muslim, whether it be Ibn Khuzaymah, and they are the highest, and there are others similar to them, highest level, even Al-Albani, rahimahullah, silsilatul sahiha. That's why Shaykh Al-Albani, all he used to revise the hadith that he was collecting. Silsilatul hadith al-sahiha, now running into volumes. I can't remember what the full volume is, what, 10, 14, something like this. Da'ifa as well. But Al-Albani, rahimahullah, just like the scholars before him, always used to revise the hadith that they have collected to make sure that if there's a mistake, they would make tarajah. They would always make recantation, check the hadith again, because that's the role of the scholar, to make sure the authenticity of the hadith. Anyway, coming back to the hadith itself, that we have what is sufficient in Bukhari and Muslim, that is authentic from the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that this is a proof of the utmost humility and humble character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam towards the young and the old. He was merciful towards the children, and he was merciful towards this young boy, his grandson. He would play with him with cheerfulness and with good nature, bringing him happiness and joy. And he is the best of creation, meaning Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best of creation without exception. And in this beautiful conduct of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is guidance for the people to be merciful towards the young and towards the old, and showing humbleness and humility towards others is written as a reward for the one who does that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And upon that, inshaAllah, we will finish for today. Wa jazakumullahu khaira. As-salam. Jazakallah khair. Our brother and al-ustad Tariq Brohi, hafidhuhullahu ta'ala, he has asked a pertinent question regarding the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he called Hassan, فَقَامَ الْحَسَنْ بِنْ عَلِي يَمْشِي وَفِي أُنُوقِهِ السِّخَابِ, that Ali bin Hassan, as a young boy, as a young child, that he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and around his neck was a beaded necklace. Now, him having a beaded necklace around his neck as a child, as something that maybe he plays with or something that they put around his neck, and this was by way of decoration, by way of, you know, beautification. To say that this was some sort of taweez or ta'weed, some sort of amulet that he had around his neck, is an exaggeration, and it is in fact an interpolation. It is to add information to the hadith that is not present in the hadith. In fact, there is no hadith that is authentically reported from Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that states that any of the children that they wore any of these types of amulets or ta'weed or anything similar to that. It is not reported from them. Tamaim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that the tamima, it is shirk to hang a amulet or any form of protective necklace or armband. Like some of the people you see wrapping ropes around their arms with a pouch, and inside of the pouch there are some words that are written, either du'as or ayat from the Quran or numbers or symbols or other than that, then all of it is forbidden. If it is the words of Allah, the book of Allah, so they have taken Surah Al-Fatiha for example, and they put it in a pouch around the neck, whether it is an adult or a young boy, then we don't say this is shirk, we say this is bid'ah. Why? Because this is the words of Allah, so we don't say it is shirk. We say it is bid'ah. Why is it bid'ah? Because a bid'ah is any deed or action that is done by a person for which there is no proof from the book of Allah, nor from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, nor from the ijma'. So if there is no proof from the book of Allah that you can hang amulets around your neck, even with the words of Allah, because never do we say about the words of Allah, by hanging the words of Allah around your neck, that is shirk in itself, because it's not shirk. These are the words of Allah. How can the words of Allah be shirk? But it is bid'ah, meaning that it is innovated. Innovated, meaning that it wasn't done by the Prophet ﷺ, and it wasn't done by the Sahaba, nor was it commanded by the Prophet ﷺ, nor did he allow it. In fact, he said the opposite. He said the opposite. Do not hang anything that is hung around the animals, meaning the cattle, that the people used to hang it around the necks of the animals in the times of Jahiliyyah as a form of protection. Or anything that is hung around any person or child, the Prophet ﷺ commanded it to be cut off. For indeed, it will not bring you any benefit, it will only bring you harm, as occurs in some narrations. So all of this is forbidden, and it is clearly forbidden. And there are chapter headings in Kitab al-Tawheed of Shaykh al-Islam, chapter headings with ayat and hadith that clearly forbid and are far from the Sahaba, that forbid the hanging of amulets. So here, to say that what Hassan was wearing was an amulet, then it is not correct to say that. So that was one side. We don't say it is a bid'ah. We don't say rather it is shirk. We say it is a bid'ah to use the Quranic ayat. However, if a person is hanging something around his neck, and by way of that he's calling upon other than Allah, so maybe there's something in there that calls upon a jinn. So some people believe that there's a jinn in a certain cave, in a certain part of Yemen, and they will call upon that jinn and they will say, ya fulan, bring this child or bring this car or bring this animal or bring my wife or my mother protection. And they wrap it up and they seal it up and they wrap it into a leather pouch and then they put it on the arm or the neck. Then that is shirkul akbar. Because that is to take refuge and to seek refuge from the jinn or from the ones in the graves, and so on. So that is something that is clearly shirk, and it is not allowed, because now they have removed themselves from trusting and relying in Allah to a jinn or to a dead one in his grave. As for, you know, people that they use symbols and numbers and so on, then all of that is just basically fraud. They're frauding the people with symbols and numbers, and that is from the habits of the Jews. Because the Jews, what they used to do with the Torah is that they used to turn the letters of the Torah, the words of the Torah, into numerical formulations. So they used to take chapters of the Torah, which is what, you know, the Jews today refer to as the Torah, and they used to make numerical formulations. So they used to say, this chapter of the Torah has this numerical formulation, 6, 8, 4, 3, and then a line, and 4, 2, 8, and they used to make a formulation as representation of something in there. But in reality, they were playing with the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what Muslims have started doing from the deviant ones, that they started making numerical formulations of the Quran as well. Like, for example, if I was to say to anyone from the anyone living, a Muslim living in India or Pakistan, what does 786 mean? There you go. Anything that, if you say to a Muslim living in, obviously in Saudi Arabia or in Kuwait or in Egypt, 786, say what? 786, is that your door number? Your phone number? What is it? They don't know. This is a numerical formulation innovated. And they have other numerical formulations. And in there may be, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, that the one who is writing it, he has some connection with the devils from the jinn. He has some communication with them. And he throws in their numerical formulations and numbers and adi'iyah. And the words of Allah, they write them backwards or upside down. Or one is right way around and one is the wrong way around. And then they introduce numbers into it and they wrap it up and they blow on it. Like the blowing of the magicians. And then they give it to your child. You're going to put that around your child's neck?
They write names of the angels as well.
Yeah. Well, they write all types of stuff on there. Jinns, the names of jinn. And they say, you know, and they think that those jinn are actually protecting them. They might even be deceived into thinking that those jinns are malaika. So they give jinns and they say, no, it's not a jinn, it's an angel. But it's a jinn, and they are calling upon devils, and some of them know and some of them don't know. So what did the Prophet ﷺ do? Cut the door. And now when you come into places like India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, even if you go to places like Iraq, Egypt, you find them wearing amulets. Some men came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 9 men or 10, and they said, and they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to take the shahada and take the bay'ah. So he took it from all of them except one. He said, ya Rasulullah, why? He said, because he's wearing an amulet. Take it off. So when he took it off, only then did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam take his oath, take his pledge of allegiance. Now, many of the people in society regard these as minor things, but they are not minor things, because these are actual fundamentals. They are not like, you know, that we differ over whether we can drink water standing up or drink water sitting down, because that is a fiqh position. No doubt it is afdal and it is better always, when you drink water, drink sitting down, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to drink water sitting down, and he forbade in a narration. So some of the scholars say it was makruh, that it is something disliked to drink water standing up. Right, so this we can differ over. You know, the narration of Ali radiallahu anhu, when they said to Ali, and he was drinking water standing up, they said, why do you drink water standing up? Indeed, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he forbade drinking water standing up. He said, why? By Allah, I saw with my own eyes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam drinking water standing up. So now the Sahaba differ over this issue of water. So that is a Amr Ijtihadi. This is the difference of opinion amongst the Sahaba. There's no difference in amulets. This is a fundamental of the religion, because this is related to your connection and your ibadah with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that whomsoever hangs something around his body, then he has committed shirk. Major issue. Whoever hangs something upon his body, meaning an amulet, whoever hangs a tamima, meaning something of protection for himself, then he has committed shirk. Hanging the Quran, then we don't say shirk, because the Prophet ﷺ wasn't talking about hanging the Quran. There's a narration in Abu Dawood that some of the people of bid'ah, they tried to use, that one of the Sahaba, that he wrote some ayat of the Quran and he placed it upon the body of her, of his children at night. That narration is weak. Now what do we say about weak narrations? You can't go to a weak narration and reject all of these authentic narrations, Bukhari and Muslim, Abu Dawud, narration after narration, forbidding hanging of amulets and hanging of these tama'im and hanging of ta'aweeth. He forbade them all. And you, to get rid of all of those authentic narrations that run into dozens and dozens of hadith, reject all of those hadith because of one weak hadith, that's when you know that a person is following hawa. You know that a person is following his desires because he just wants something to support his position. So therefore, you know, using this hadith, that Hassan had a necklace of beads around his neck to say that he was wearing a tamima, it's not correct to say that, barakallahu fi. And plus he was a baby. So children, you know, they have a hukum of toys. You know, you don't expect a grown woman of 23 years old to be playing with dolls. But for children, they can play with dolls and teddy bears and whatever else. It is allowed for children, but not for grown people. For children, the rulings are slightly, like if your child is musbil, 5 years old, say, what are you doing? Raise your trousers above your ankles. You know, for the children, it doesn't apply. If your daughter is 6, 7, 8 years old and she hasn't reached the age of puberty, you can't say to her, why are you walking around without hijab on and you hit her? No, you don't hit her. You know, because the ahkam of the sharia are not obligated upon her at that age. So for the children, the rulings are different than they are for adults. And of course, a grown man is not allowed to wear, you know, jewelry and so on, except the ring. He's allowed to wear a ring because Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wore a ring. As for the rest of the jewelry, like a man wearing an anklet, ajib. No, or a man wearing a bracelet, you know, because they think, you know, nowadays, but you see it. Man wearing a bracelet, why are you wearing a bracelet? Because it looks nice. Well, why do you wear an anklet? Maybe that looks nice. Say, no, that's feminine. So how is that masculine and that's feminine? Men don't wear, this is not from the behavior of men to wear bracelets or to wear necklaces or to wear earrings.
There's a lot of people wearing bangles in Pakistan.
Yeah, I mean,
never seen that shit.
Those steel bangles.
Yeah.
Steel, that's from the Sikhs. That's one of the five, you know, the Kara. All of that is haram from two aspects. Three aspects. Number one, it is resemblant of an amulet. Number two, it is imitating the kuffar. Number three, it is imitating the women. From all three angles, it is haram. Kuffar, why do you want to wear the... You know, because you're all, you know, it's imitation of the Hindus as well, because they wear bands around their... We are Muslims. We should have our own Islamic identity. We don't need anybody else's. Allah has blessed us with Islam. We don't need anything else. And whatever is in the culture of our people in Pakistan or Saudi Arabia or Egypt or Morocco that doesn't oppose the Sharia, then there's no harm at all. So for example, the clothing that we're wearing. Or, you know, whatever, you know, the type of, you know, wrap around the head that you wear. Or the trousers of the Turks. Or the white trousers of the Syrians. And all of that is allowed. Why? Because there's no contradiction between that and the Sharia. Anything in the custom that does not contradict the Sharia, then we have no problem with it. Because this is the urf of the people. This is the urf of the people. And the urf of the people we have no problem with, unless it contradicts the hadith. If it contradicts the hadith, you can take yourself and your urf and put it where it belongs, in the trash can. Right? But the hadith, well, not the yugo belong in the trash can, but the urf belongs in the trash can. All right? Because that custom, if it is not supported by Islam or Islam contradicts it, then what do you put forward? If a person comes along and he says, well, in our customs in Pakistan, when a woman dies, we lock her up and tell her to shave her head. Say, no, you should be locked up and your head should be shaven as a punishment, not hers. She's in mourning. Her mourning period is 4 months and 10 days. She doesn't have to shave her head. We're not Hindus. We don't imprison her. But she does stay in her family home. And she does not leave for 4 months and 10 days. And she does not beautify herself. And all her relatives help her if she needs anything and so on. And if she needs to go to the hospital or to the doctor, she's allowed to go and come back. But we do not behave like the Hindus. Or like the Jews, when a woman is in menstruation, they won't even touch a utensil that she's touched. They'll give her a private room and they don't even go near her or even talk to her. So that custom has got nothing to do with Islam. Aisha said, radiallahu anha, when she said when his wives were on menstruation, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would do everything with them except the actual act of intimacy. Everything else he would do, he would kiss them, embrace them, so on and so forth, play with them, but he would not actually have the relationship, the intimate relationship itself. This is Islam. Islam doesn't need, you know, Islam is so powerful in its own innate culture and its own, you know, traditions, that there is nothing that can come against Islam except that Islam overpowers it. Because it's rooted in wisdom and revelation from Allah. There is no custom of the people, whether in marriage or divorce or death. Someone dies and, you know, we have to do a big gathering for the people and feed 45 families that have come to mourn. The Prophet ﷺ didn't allow that type of mourning to take place. He didn't allow that. That you gather the people after someone has died, and then you do what they call them, the matam or whatever they call it, right? So they come, and then you have, you know, 100 families sitting in the house of the person's family who has died, of the deceased family's house. And they sit there for 3 days. They take out all the... Like Shaykh al-Albani said, rahimahullah, in Ahkam al-Janais, he said what they do is they take out the furniture of the house and they put it outside. And all of the people, they gather in the house and then they feed them and whatever. Where's this from? The hadith of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In fact, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum used to say that we used to consider the gathering of the people for mourning to be from wailing. The wailing which Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade. In a hadith he said, they are not from us who tear their pockets and slap their faces and call out with the calls of jahiliyyah. They are not from us. Mourning, first and foremost, should be done in the... We don't care about culture. And it's hard in a country like this, or in Muslim societies, to say, this is the hadith. They say, oh, well, what we've been doing for the last 50, 60 years, for generations. You say, well, you've been doing wrong, because it's just one person following another. Here's the hadith. Look, what do you want me to tell you? Here's the hadith. Well, we don't want that hadith. What do we do now? Can't do anything. Here's the hadith. We don't want that hadith. We're going to do what our forefathers did. What can you do now? You're just patient, make dua, and go on your way. And you hope that Allah will guide them one day. But as for us, no, we don't do that. Barakallahu feek.